on this. I think one thing that needs to be done immediately and which all of us need to ensure is to ensure continuity of services, right? I think it's absolutely a moral, ethical imperative to ensure that the services that are there, even if they are fractured, even if they are minimal, to deliver to the best of their capacities. At the moment, most public health facilities as well as private health facilities are inordinately either focused on COVID alone or are scaling down other services significantly, which is leading to a huge risk of increased mortality due to many other causes. I mean, we are seeing it day in and day out. And it's going to become a huge problem in times to come if the current services do not gear up to provide the whole set of services. Immunization, for example, a month or two of disruption in measles immunization is going to cause havoc in times to come. Tuberculosis, yesterday a study came which said that in India alone, 150,000 to 500,000 additional deaths due to tuberculosis in the next 3 to 4 years. We are seeing how people are being denied services for detection as well as continuation of treatment for tuberculosis, cancers. Last month, 100,000 lesser patients of cancer attended the OPD in India. What is it going to do to cancer care and to the survival of the patients there? So I think the first absolute urgent imperative is to have a balanced approach. The question is not to chase a virus. The question is, how do you promote well-being of people? If, the common refrain these days is that people will die of hunger, if not of COVID. It's true for so many other conditions that they're facing right now. We are seeing people dying on the streets, being run over, and as I said, due to many other illnesses, because there are no services at all. I mean, whatever was there is also being used to much lesser of its potential. We were great in reasonably good in immunization coverage, for example, and that's, again, something that's not happening at all. So I think we have to kind of get over this obsession with COVID while we do what we can to prevent its spread, etc. But we do need to see that what else is kind of imperative. The second, which is related, is that while doing so, we do it in a manner that strengthens primary healthcare, right? I mean, so as Abhay said, that there is, it's an opportunity also to see that what long-term changes can happen. And I think if we use, the COVID, if we believe in the fact that we are going to live with the virus for a long time to come, there is no way but to ensure a continuous surveillance. And that's possible. And in India, as opposed to the relative advantage, as I said, is that there is a huge network of primary health centers who, even now, even as we speak, while that doesn't come often in newspapers or in media, are doing large numbers of surveillance, promoting home isolation. They can do it better, sure. But they are the ones who are out there. In the Kerala story, yeah. Ashas and everybody did a wonderful job to do contact tracing. And who else is going to do that in such a large country with such distances and remoteness and difficult to access? So I think while kind of addressing the current situation, ensuring that there is a non-COVID situation being dealt with adequately, and strengthening the systems for surveillance for COVID, which also strengthens the primary healthcare systems in the long run. I mean, one example that we've been pushing a lot is that a large number of people, even with moderate to severe conditions, can be managed in a more decentralized manner, right? I mean, except for those, very small proportion of 5% who require ventilators, most others can be maintained, managed at the primary health center, community health center, and a district hospital level. At the moment, everybody is being pushed to tertiary hospitals, which is going to cause more transmission, etc. So I think, and for example, at this time point of time, ensuring that oxygen is available in all the public health facilities can go a long way in preventing a large number of deaths subsequently and ramping up the system. So I think ramping up the primary healthcare system is the second kind of imperative that we have now. And I think there are a lot of questions around whether it should be private or public. I think as long as the public systems are in the driving seat, and the healthcare at the doorstep is affordable to people, is what I think to my mind is the right to health. I mean, whoever delivers it is a second matter, but it has to be affordable, and the government has to have a huge role in ensuring fairness and affordability and access to healthcare.